diverse women in the transnational construction of identity. So now we have been talking about present, and we're going to the past. And the past, I think, informs the present. Dr. Cosentino is an associate professor of the history of art and architecture at DePaul University. She is an art historian whose research focuses on Mexican visual culture from the late post-classic to more contemporary practices. Several of her current projects focus on the colonial production under the Spanish American Empire, including Nahuatl Horastic Codices, Antiguan Silver, and Mendicant Art. To know what that is about. But please help me welcome Dr. Cosentino.
A thought to chew on before I get to the substance part of my talk. I looked at some recent articles by psychologists on memory just to sort of get myself into the right framework for this day, and was interested in the observation by many psychologists, obvious probably, that we can all relate to at some level, that the vast majority of memories involve visual imagery. Most of this visual memory is in color, and our earliest memories are fragmentary and elusive. And one more thought that I think has already come up as a sub-theme here is that we select memories in accord with our present needs and self-conceptions. So these thoughts may be instructive as we think about the kind of imagery that gets circulated and cemented in people's memories, both individual and collective, and helps to construct a sense of identity, whether it's personal, civic, and national. Now, more specifically, my talk takes us to the geography of 20th century Mexico and the way in which Mexicanidad, or Mexican identity, has been shaped transnationally, sort of a dialogue in some ways between the United States and Mexico. We're going more precisely to the area of Mexico City, which is marked here on this flag by the feet of the eagle, that iconic symbol at the center of the national flag. Mexico City was home to a couple of Anglo artists from the U.S. that I'm going to talk about today. Texan painter Emily Edwards, who lived there in the 1930s, and graphic designer Lance Wyman, who lived in New York, but in the 1960s lived for a time in Mexico City. Both of these artists produced visual material that formed part of a larger government-supported effort to secure local, national, and international conceptions of identity. Now the largest metropolitan area of the Western Hemisphere, Mexico City in the 20th century was a booming capital whose growing size and spatial associations helped to both unify and homogenize a modern sense of collective Mexican memory. So if I can have the next image, I think right away you'll begin to notice a few themes in my talk, a few of which are nicely highlighted in one of Viviana's works. Aves Sagradas juxtaposes the silhouette of the golden eagle. You can see it better, probably right in front of your face here, against the back wall. This golden eagle swooping in this delicious curlicued flight pattern from the coastal shores of Mexico on the left to the deserts of El Paso on the right. Common, no doubt, on Mexican immigration and the flight that transcends geography and national borders. I, too, am interested in the geography of identity, and map space figures prominently in this talk. Eagles do as well. Both are part of this artistic and broader cultural dialogue between the U.S. and Mexico that emerges in the 20th century in really pronounced ways. The first thing to understand, and surely many of you already know this, but a century ago, Mexico was a politically fragmented country, not yet culturally or socially integrated into today's modern nation. There was no deeply felt nationalism or cultural unity. And from 1910 to 20, a civil war stirred chaos across the country and right to the center of its capital city, where the longtime dictator Porfirio Diaz was deposed. And following the Mexican Revolution, there were efforts to establish a more progressive modern nation. And a modern form of nationalism really began to take shape at this moment in the 1920s. A lively group of revolutionary elites promoted popular politics in an effort to unify a wounded nation. These cultural elites included the well-known muralist Diego Rivera, and of course, Jose Vasconcelos, the Minister of Education, supported him in the government. So this was a period of great optimism and socialist ideals that characterized what Simon called the so-called cosmopolitan Mexican summer. And this attracted a number of U.S. artists, journalists, and intellectuals who basked in the warm post-war glow. Next slide, please. Among those who were seduced by the so-called Mexican vogue was the Texan teacher and artist Emily Edwards, who made this map, the colorful form on the right here, the map of La Ciudad de México y el de Dolores, hoy en día, map of Mexico City and its surroundings in 1932. But first, I should say, she got her cultural footing right here in Chicago, art educated at the Art Institute. She experienced the grittier realities of modernity while working at Jane Addams' settlement project, Hull House, and then went to Mexico in 1925, where she befriended Diego Rivera and worked in his studio alongside him. And she encountered a government eager to support artists who were socially minded and would help construct this sense of modern Mexican identity. So the map is Edwards' vision of Mexico City as a standing figure in profile. I hope you can kind of read it here, but it shows the city in the shape of an Aztec eagle warrior. His beaked head is in the north there. You may catch a glimpse of the eye. His feet are planted on the rocky foundations known as Pedregal to the south of the city. And the shading at the mid-city suggests kind of a feathered wing, which is coordinate with this image of the Aztec eagle warrior. Meanwhile, red and yellow lines run all through the city, like liquid through veins. Power lines and electric tramways converge on the urban body's heart, the city's historic Zócalo, or central plaza. That's that circular form. So I'm sorry, I didn't bring my pointer. I'm terrible at historian from other members, but there's a sort of circular form here that's made by the red tram lines that encircle like, the heart, the Zócalo, the central plaza. And now maps have existed of this area since at least the Spanish conquest, but this map really takes the civic concept in a new direction, symbolic of this kind of emergent Mexicanidad. So I think this is a fascinating indicator of the cultural politics of the time. It could certainly be dismissed as an exoticized vision of the city by a gringa, a woman, no less. But I actually think that she was tuned quite well into the capital city's cultural zeitgeist. Moment. The 1930s was this time of new technologies, modernity. Tramways are now entirely electric, the precursor to Mexico City's now great subway system. And actually down here on the right, that little photo shows this really funny event that happens the same year that this poster, this image of the city is made. It is a funeral for the last mule-drawn tramway in Mexico City, and there were advertisements circulated saying, come and bid your farewell to this last mule. They played Chopin's Requiem, they said, don't bring flowers, but do come. So there's obviously this air of a kind of a new beginning. Aviation is certainly providing early adventurers with a kind of synoptic view, the overview suggested by the map itself, now available by those who can buy a map because it was available for sale, to those whose feet remain firmly on the ground. So the map suggests that space is being democratized, it's consumable by a general public, who can again buy this print that's been reproduced, and we see the commodification of a kind of a civic identity that's important for both residents and for foreign visitors. This is marking the beginning of Mexico as a sort of a destination, especially for tourists from the US. Next slide, please. So modernity is half of the aspect of Mexicanidad, which was emergent at this moment. The other half was historically distinctive. Revolutionary elites are mining the indigenous past for national identity. And of course, the Aztecs provide foundations for that search. Aztecs have been an imperialistic society, the most powerful cultural unifier before the Spanish conquest. They codified aesthetics and provided an ample resource to draw from. And at this moment as well, archaeological excavations are being ratcheted up. So excavations of places like Teotihuacan. For those of you who have been to Mexico, you've surely at least heard of Teotihuacan and perhaps visited there because it's an easy day trip from the city. But also, right underneath Mexico City, the remains of Tenochtitlan are coming to light. Major temple pyramids forming the heart of that Aztec capital city are revealed in great holes in the plaza, the Zocalo, probably best seen by those riding those trams all around the center. So on the left here is an example of the kinds of artifacts that were being unearthed. I should mention how that this particular terracotta figure is a recent find, but you can see how it provides the kind of imagery that clearly was inspiring Edwards when she created her map. This is representative, this eagle warrior is representative of these imperial soldiers among the Aztecs, brigades of imperial soldiers who fought enemies while cloaked in masks and feathers. And Edwards wrote about how this valiant Aztec figure, quote, seems to symbolize Mexico. So with her map, she's definitely translating this cultural ideal into a geographic one. And she's pushing the notion that the Aztec corpus is intact and ready mobilized. Her figure in the map, Mexico City itself, is a cowering, a lying prone. The figure actually points a spear. I don't know if you can see it, but again, it's sort of the spear on the map is pointing right to the head of the terracotta figure there. So that gives you the sense that Mexico City, or the civic identity, is ready to fight. It has agency. Mexico City has agency. Next slide, please. So for her map, Edwards is gathering these fragments of the Aztec past to fit the needs of the post-revolutionary period. And she's clearly inspired by other Aztec forms as well, like the very well-known Codex Mendoza. This is a prime example of Mexican patrimony, these codices that use pictorial writing to communicate complex narratives, painted by Aztec artists, this one in the mid-16th century, using icons and lithic representations instead of words to record information. So this map that we see on the left, it's a stylized representation of the Aztec capital city of Tenochtitlan, and it reflects a vision of the island city as a sort of an axis mundi. The blue water, the blue area reflects the water of Lake Texcoco upon which Tenochtitlan sat, this island city sat. And then you see these bisecting diagonal lines showing the watery canals that, you know, cut through that capital city way back when. So Edwards's image is clearly memorializing things like the Codex Mendoza. Both of these maps show symbolic images of the same location. The modern print, Edwards's print, seizes on Mendoza's distinctive order of glyphic notations. And the Aztec map is framed by a border of cartouches or squares that are filled with calligraphic glyphs. Well, Edwards is filled with these toponyms or images of cities that surround the basin of Mexico. Next slide shows one particular glyph that's significantly located in both of the maps, and that is the Aztec. That is the image of the eagle and the cactus that now forms part of the national flag. This is a shorthand reference, of course, to a foundational narrative, the story that tells how the city of Tenochtitlan, now Mexico City, was divinely sanctioned by the Aztec patron deity, Huitzilopochtli. He said that the Aztecs, as they migrated across Mexico, would know where to settle when they saw this vision of this eagle alighting on the cactus. And sometimes it's shown in shorthand, just the cactus growing out of a stone. But either way, it represents this place sign for Tenochtitlan. Tenochtitlan means place of the nopal cactus. So it's a geographic marker, this place sign is. And it's incorporated right there into Edwards's map of Mexico City, right sitting directly above the eagle's head there. And I've highlighted it in red. I think that, here, the next slide, if you will. I think that the map is important. Edwards's map is important, remembering that this is 1932 when Edwards creates this map. It marks a transformational moment in civic history for Mexico City. It's a marker of this newfound urban cosmopolitanism. It's a sign of a modern city that's understandable. It makes visitors and residents feel at home in this consumable, identifiable area. And it helps to codify a sense of what it means to be Mexican, both for Mexican nationals and for foreigners. It takes this fragmented imagery from the Aztec past and creates a tangible urban sphere. So in this map, we see that the nation is simultaneously modern and historic, a hallmark of Mexico. So Mexico City at this moment is growing very rapidly. A little detail in the black and white there, not detail, but the image on the black and white, shows the growth of Mexico City from the moment of the toppling of Tenochtitlan in 1521 to about the 1940s. You can see that Mexico City is just growing exponentially. It's becoming a magnet for provincial Mexicans for economic and political reasons. It marks a real beginning of U.S. tourism, as I mentioned. And there's this demographic explosion in the 1940s and 50s. In the 1940s, we've got 1.7 million people, and then by the end of the 1950s, 5.4 million people. So incredible growth. If I may have the next image, you'll see why this is all relevant. By the 1960s, the city is truly challenged by this growth. And there's the sense that the cohesive city has absolutely been lost. The landscape begins to overwhelm. Massive modernist projects kick into high gear. Mexico City had already become a concrete jungle in the 1960s. And traversing the city had become very difficult. Cars and tramways congested that Zocalo area that we saw in Edwards' map. And so plans are afoot to confront the challenge, and the solution is one of Mexico City's prime engineering projects, the subway. In the downtown zone, as I say, traffic was less than walking pace, so this was a real solution, and this was, once again, a transnational project. I say once again because the tramways were also transnationally supported. It was a French-Canadian company that had really provided the infrastructure for the tramways, and it also was a French-Canadian company that produced the subway cars and did much of the engineering. So if I have the next slide, you'll see that the transnational aspect of the changing horizon of Mexico City continues when the government holds a contest for the branding of the metro system, the subway system in Mexico City. And the contract was won by New York designer Lance Wyman, who was trained at Brooklyn's Pratt Institute in Bauhaus and Swiss design. He had been the one who, just a year or two earlier, had won the designing of the Mexico City Olympics of 1968. And I've actually shown you in the upper left, right-hand corner there is one of his logos for the Mexico City Olympics of 1968. He designed this really elegant system of signage, mixing op art with what he encountered at Mexico's finest museums, pictorial writing. So he created this very successful project for the graphics for the Olympics, and then for the Metro project, he took a similar approach. His idea was to create this sort of minimalist logo relating the name of the station to or the area around it. So he was imagining the fact that this is a multilingual city, so a system based on visual signs and colors made a lot of sense. It was a collection really of icons, and I think that this is not so different in concept. If you look at the sort of the upper left-hand corner there, a collection of some of these metro signs that he comes up with, not so different in concept from the Memoria project, or eerily like the iPhone-like logo that we probably all have on our phones in front of them. These all transcend any specific language. They use color, they use visual forms. And in the case of the metro system, the first line to be constructed was this pink or magenta line that you see cutting through through the center of the city there. And each station along the line has this unique logo or icon based on any nearby point of reference. So you see highlighted here the Salto de Agua, which shows a local fountain in a little simplified glyph. And then the Merced, which shows a box of apples because it's located adjacent to the largest outdoor markets in the city. Next slide, and I'm finishing up here. But the quintessential example is the Pino Suárez station. And this is just an interesting observation about the disjunction between the imagery and the name. The icon depicts not the vice president after which the actual measure stock was named, but rather a pyramid. It captures the image of the pyramid dedicated to Tehecat, the Aztec god of wind, which was discovered while the station was being constructed. So in this case, and more broadly, ancient visual forms are permeating the modern metro system, and even that sort of the depiction of the line along the right hand of this image shows you the entire pink line and all the icons there, which read a lot like the annals of the Aztec codices, which just list these glyphs, glyph upon glyph, and capture a sense of like iconography in a single strip or linear presentation. If I can have the next image, please. So the metro iconography is now a profound part of life in Mexico City. A Mexican literature professor, Juan Goergen, has written, quote, large cities lack a structured language. They can only aspire to a broken language, a mosaic fragmented by limitless growth and exuberant chaos, end quote. And people have observed, who study cities, that especially these mega cities like Mexico City, the only way to make it cohere, to give it meaning, is to actually travel through the city. And for those 6 million people who ride the metro daily, the imagery associated with the metro gives meaning to the modern city. The nationalist imagery in the design of the station name serves to feed a kind of collective imagination of its ridership. It shaped the way in which people interact with and remember specific spaces in the city. Citizens of Mexico City, Chilangos, will often identify their place in the city, their home, their residence, with the place sign or the toponym associated with the closest metro station. So, and everybody to some degree lays claim to the metro sign at the center of it all, the Zocalo or Central Plaza, at the heart of the city. Again, this is a place where civic identity is played out on a sprawling open plaza with a flag at the center against the backdrop of the National Palace. The station icon is naturally the silhouetted eagle on the cactus, and this was, after all, the spot where the Aztecs claimed that the cactus had grown. So if I may have the last image here, I just want to throw out this idea that, or these thoughts, of what do these constructions of Mexicanidad have to do with transnational Mexicans? As Mexican immigration to the U.S. soared in the 20th century, there was no pre-existing Mexican national identity per se. It was fragmented, Mexico was fragmented. And this unifying identity had to be created among Mexican immigrants. In the 1920s, civic and commercial organizations, for instance in Chicago, promoted patriotism among working class migrants by urging the embrace of cultural identification with the Mexican nation. Community formation project in cities throughout the United States in many ways is inseparable from the national integration project in Mexico. I think this compels us to revise how we might think about nations and national boundaries. Relationship, the relationship between cultural practices, especially aesthetics, and ethnic identities, and about the connection between a Mexican national identity and Mexican American identities. Chicago migrants lived beyond the political boundaries of Mexico. They adopted new versions of Mexicanidad being promoted by cultural elites back in Mexico City, even though most of these immigrants did not come from Mexico City, and therefore wouldn't have had such visceral connections with, say, the Zocalo. In personal experiences and collective national activities, 20th century Mexican transnationals drew upon and reshaped ideas and symbols that emerged from the unifying nationalist project in the post-revolutionary period beyond. Such colorful and fragmented memories have been carefully selected to accord with the contemporary sense of Mexicanidad on both sides of the border. Thank you.